So let's get started right away. To introduce my first celebrity, I would like to play a video of hers, Vaishali. She's wearing the Google Glass. What are you augmenting?
Everybody here, I can take a photo of anybody, I can record videos of people. I don't have that app right now, but I can actually even transcript anything you're saying in a different language. So I can be translating anything. Like that. Where are you sitting? This is the technology of today.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, so for those at the back who couldn't hear me, this is the Google Glass. It's one of the famous wearable computing devices available in the market today. And we create a lot of AR apps for this device and others. And what I can do with it right now is I can turn it on. I can take a picture of the room. I can take videos. I can transcript anything that somebody's saying in English into Hindi. I don't have that app right now, but I wish I could share what I'm seeing on this with you. Unfortunately, it didn't work out. But yes, this is the Google Glass.
Vaishali, welcome. Please. So this is a very, very niche area for anyone to start a business in. Vaishali, tell us, how did you land up here?
So actually, that's a long story. We as a company started out doing simple things like web applications, Facebook applications. I say simple, but doing a Facebook application is not simple. They change their API every other month. So that's how we started out. But it so happened that on a chance visit to the Golconda Fort in Hyderabad, me and my partner, we were taking a client then. We kind of just started thinking, how would it be to imagine this fort in its heyday, you know, in a bygone era, to kind of see the kind of clothes that people wore at that time, how the fort walls looked. And that's how we kind of chanced upon this technology called augmented reality, which most of you here might not be aware of. How many people in the audience have heard of augmented reality? Wow, very impressive. So this technology actually has been existing for a few decades now. The reason it's come into prominence now is because with the kind of computing devices we have, like the smartphone I'm holding is more powerful than the Apollo 11, which put man on the moon. So because of the powerful devices we have now is why augmented reality is something that's a possibility now, because the kind of processing power you need and the graphics and the heavy-duty application that an AR app is can only work on a really, really good and powerful device. And now I can create AR apps for my smartphone, for my tablet, for the Google Glass, and augmented reality is very much a possibility now.
So you've built so many apps, right? You've built Facebook apps, you've built mobile apps, and so on. So tell us about the journey of an app. When, after you get an idea, where do you start? How? What are the first steps of building an app and going all the way to the app store?
Well, the first thing we do with an idea is try to examine it from different perspectives, bounce it off of people, our mentors, people in the startup community, to understand whether that idea actually has any kind of market potential. Because it's important to understand whether what you might have as an idea is actually solving a problem. And unless that really exists, it's difficult to make it work, especially if it's a consumer-based application. Luckily for us, we do a lot of B2B apps, so we create other people's ideas. So startups come to us with an idea that they want to create, and we take it up. Now, how we begin is initially all the stakeholders in the system, they have to be on the same page in terms of where that idea is going. So it's examined from different perspectives, an entire wireframe and mock-ups are done to understand the UI, the user flow, the functionalities and the features that the application would have. So that's the beginning, the first thing that we do. Next, obviously, once the design is a little clearer, once the flow is clearer, the big part of development comes about. And as a lot of you, you know, who are developers here would know, it's very difficult to sometimes to identify what are the best technologies to use. In my case, my CTO loves PHP, so he's a fan of C, so to speak. So the gradual increase is obviously to PHP. So everything that we do is PHP. And using specifically the Laravel framework. But again, it depends on your developers. Everything now is as good as the next in kind of creating the kind of application that you actually want at the end. Beyond this, so once the development begins happening, it's very important at different stages of this entire process to bounce off everything that's happening with all the stakeholders in the system. Because sometimes, especially if this is done as a service for another person, people tend to be on different pages about the same thing. And clarifying and understanding that is very important at each point. Also, technically, sometimes things become clearer in terms of maybe a better technology could be used in this point, or maybe this feature is redundant and something else could be done. And that kind of brainstorming happens in the process of the development. So it's very important to keep relooking at everything that you're doing, even if you've set it, you know, if you've set out all the requirements in the beginning. And obviously, some people follow the waterfall methodology. Some people follow the agile method. So it really depends on your programmers and you as developers what you want to follow in the developmental process. So that's about it.
So I mean, to just summarize those two points that I think you should, as app makers, take notes of is idea validation and how to go about it. Then is the choice of technology. And an interesting point that you brought in was the comfort and the favoritism of technology. So there is no really right answer in terms of choosing, but it's okay to choose by comfort.
And absolutely.
Yeah. So how big a team did you need for, you know, some of your apps? If one of us wants to start you know, our own company and make apps, how big a team do we need?
So I think that's actually a flexible question with a flexible answer. It depends on how much time you have and how much money you have. If you have a lot of money but you're short on time, you hire 10 developers to do what one can do in a longer period of time. Because sometimes you actually realize that it's better to have multiple developers working on a project, but sometimes because we as developers understand that each of us has our own favoritism, partiality to certain languages, it's often difficult to collaborate with other developers. So really, depending on your need, based on the time frame and the money that you have, that depends on how many people can do a project. So one can do it, 10 can do it.
Okay, I have a lot more to talk to you, but I also want our next guest to join us, and that's Pragati. Can we have her video?
Pragati is the chief technology evangelist in PayPal. Her journey with mobile is a very interesting one. Let's hear in her own words.
My journey with mobile started on an interesting note. Motorola came on campus looking for people with mobile skills. Since I didn't have any, I gate crashed their interview and attended the invite only interviews with no invite at all. What keeps me going is my passion to bring people and technology together. So I do a lot of hackathons, tech talks, meetups, conferences, blogging, publications. It gives me immense pleasure when I see a smile on people's face when they finally get how a piece of technology works. I decided to bring all my learnings, my experiences together in a book. And in 2013, I published my book on Android Application Security Essentials. I dedicate the book to my mother because she's the reason for who I am and why I am. This year, I received the Zinnov Thought Leadership Award, recognizing my contributions in different technology ecosystem initiatives. I firmly believe that you should dream big, because if you believe in something with all your heart, you'll find a way to get it.
Please welcome the Chief Evangelist of PayPal, Pragati. So Pragati, you're in PayPal. I have to start with this question. How should I make money?
You put me on the spot there because this is a really tricky question. And I'll tell you, the way to make money depends on your use case and also your intent. So let me give you examples. Let's say you're working on an app that people use all the time. Let's say it's a ticker app, right? It gives you the news that's happening right now, or gives you stock prices and stuff that people are looking at all the time. You might like to throw in some ads that people will click, and that's your revenue generator. On the other hand, if you have an app like PayPal that people use only for a specific purpose, in that case, if you throw in an ad, even though people might click on it, you're not going to end up with a lot of money. So you'd rather keep the app, you know, you might price it, you might keep it free, but give users a really good experience. Also, let's say if your app is into a niche business, like it solves a problem of helping you read properly on your phone in dark. Now that's a really niche area. And people will buy your app because it's giving them a very useful utility. So you might like to have it priced, let's say $5 or a higher price, because people are going to pay the premium to get that functionality. If you're into, let's say, games, you might like to keep the app free and follow the freemium model. When you have people get advanced gaming features by paying a price, or they end up buying digital goods like a sword or you name it. So those are different kinds of models. If you're into the media business, you can go for a subscription model, right? You get some journals for free, but if you want to access the entire thing, you need to take a subscription. So these are all different kinds of ways to make money.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's like, you know, it makes you feel better that there are so many ways of making money. Mm-hmm. It makes you feel confident to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
Yeah, but so to make a lot of money, one of the base requirements would be to have a lot of users. Right, so from a platform perspective, we hear about this viral growth. Are there any platform offerings to go viral, say, on any platform?
So I'll take a step back and let's talk about the viral growth that you're talking about. And so it's a marketing thing, right? People try to develop a lot of mathematical formulae around it, and none has succeeded so far, just because when the reality strikes and all the mathematical formulae really break. So so what, in the simplest terms, what viral growth could be, let's say Prerna makes a really fantastic app, okay? And I, as a user, install the app. I love the app. So what I do is I say, I sent a note to Vishali and say, hey Vishali, this is a great app, why don't you download it as well? She goes ahead and downloads it. She loves it. She forwards it to her CTO, who is a Python guru, right? And I say, this is a Python-based app, you would like it. So this is how it's growing. So for each customer that Prerna gets for her app, she gets another one. We could say this is a viral growth of coefficient one. That's how some people put it. But you know what? There are different, and that's where when I said the reality strikes happens, because I might really like your app, but I might take like a week to recommend it to Vaishali. Would you call it a viral growth? I still got you a customer, but look at the time delay of 1 week, right? And what if I take your app, I recommend it to Vaishali, and Vaishali said, I like it, but not so much. It's taking a lot of real estate on my phone. I delete it, right? So you lost a customer. You got viral growth, but you lost it. So these are all different ways of viral growth.
Okay, so apart from that, what do we, when we say there is an API for everything, right? So there are internet platforms, so Facebook offers the Graph API, and then every store gives something for social share patterns and so on. So what do we really mean by there is an API for everything? What are the API that an app maker should be aware of?
Well, I'll say, if there isn't an API for something right now, I bet there's somebody working really hard to create that API, right? The time has gone where people took like an year to come up with the first iteration of something. They want to just bring it to the market and fail fast if they have to. So what happens is, we as a developer would focus on the real problem, the real issue that we are trying to target. And if, let's say, I want to integrate payments, why would I go all the way understanding the payment ecosystem? And let me tell you, it's really complex. I would just go get PayPal's API and integrate into my system. I want to add social media, or the ability to share it with my friends. I'm not going to write a whole Facebook app or a Twitter app. I would just use an API and use the functionality that they have already built up. So that's what I mean by, there is an API for it. And I would say if there isn't, either somebody is building it, and if you end up building it, please outsource it, because that would be a good revenue source for you too.
Yeah, so can I exaggerate a bit and say that if you don't have an API for something, then it's an unsolved problem? And if you are solving it, go patent the solution.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so there is an API for everything, is, we're hearing that from Pragati as well. And at this step, I want to, take it to a sort of more discussion on some advanced concepts of apps, and then we'll have a lot more in-depth discussion. I want to welcome our next guest, Khushbu. Can we have her video?
Khushbu Taneja is Principal Group Program Manager and heads program management for the health and fitness vertical in the Information and Content Experiences Group. She joined Microsoft 10 years ago after completing her MBA from ISB in 2004. The team is responsible for the MSN Health and Fitness app on Windows 8.1, MSN Health and Fitness app for Windows Phone, the MSN Health channel on MSN.com, Health Answers on Search, Bing.com and Cortana, and a backend built on Azure and Bing technologies that powers the above experiences across global markets and platforms. Some of these were first of their kind offerings from Microsoft, demoed during the Build Conference 2014 keynote with great applause from the audience. This has also been widely recognized as the next big thing by tech communities. It is the number one app in the health and fitness category on Windows Phone Store, beating established competitors, and has been listed in the top 10 innovative new fitness tech products of 2014 in Collective Evolution, and has been quoted by Paul Thurrott on Win Superside as the new Bing app I wanted to get on mobile most of all. She was awarded the Inspiration Award this year, which is an annual platform to recognize extraordinary women of impact at Microsoft India. Leading the way for MSN Health and Fitness, MSN.com Health, Desktop App, Windows Phone App, Fitness, Workouts, Exercises, Exercise Tracker, GPS Tracker, Pedometer, Nutrition, Diets, Foods, Diet Tracker, Medical, Symptom Checker, 3D Body Maps, and coming soon on Android and iOS too. Same awesome experience on web, desktops, tablets, phones, and more.
So, Khushbu, we saw that you have the same experience on the web, on the desktop, on the tablet, on the phone. How do you design for that?
Yeah, that's the burning question. How do you design for that? Because obviously in this apps era, design is the number one thing, you know, because if an app is not good looking, you won't use it. At least that's me. I don't know about all of you. If it has to be good looking. And right now, the devices, the sizes, the capabilities, everything is a blur, you know. There's no line between what is a phone, what is a tablet, what is a phablet. I mean, people look at this phone and say, is this a phone? Is this a tablet? Is it a phablet? You know, sizes are just, it's a continuum now. So it's a huge challenge to design apps for that. And the industry norm and the term, the buzzword for that is responsive design. So how many of you have heard of responsive design? Okay, quite a few. But I would just say a couple of things that we keep in mind when we do responsive design is basically things like, can we be smart about not having to design the app over and over again, for a small size phone, for a tablet, for a mid-size phone? How do you do that? So then there are certain tricks, you know, there's can be designed in such a way that certain elements flow when the screen size is reduced. So if you're showing, say, 5 stories or 5 news articles, but if the phone size is small, then it wraps itself and it comes down. There's one trick like that. The other thing is that if you have the number of stories, like if it's a news app and you're showing 20 stories, then while on the list you might have 20 stories, but depending on the size of the phone or the size of the tablet, you might start clipping the number of stories that you're showing or the metadata that you're showing with that particular entity. So there are various ways of doing responsive design, but I would also like everyone to remember that at the end of the day, you're designing for the user and you have to do what's best for the user. I personally think we should not overdo responsive design. Yes, it's a great way to engineer efficiently, but at the end of the day, if the demand is that for an iPad, I have to design a little differently from an iPhone, we should do it. We should not optimize in such a way that we're at the end of the day making trade-offs from a design perspective. So that's my take on this.
That's about the design part, right? But each of these devices is having different capabilities. So how do we build an app to build a true connected experience, which is where the world is getting at?
Yes, so I'm glad you brought the point about device capabilities, because as you all saw, you know, I worked in the health and fitness business, and I don't know how many of you are aware, but that's a business where a lot is happening right now. You know, every company practically is doing something. And a lot depends on the device capability. So for example, one of the things that we did was build a pedometer on the phone itself. So a lot of you might be using, bands and Fitbits and Jawbones. But what if your phone itself could detect the number of steps that you're taking and tell you how many calories you burn? And for that, you know, today Windows phones, the Lumia series that we have, iPhone 5S, the new 6 series of iPhone, everybody has that chip which actually does very, very accurate activity detection. It could detect things like how many floors have you climbed, etc. So you have to be well aware of all the new capabilities that the phone, that the devices are coming with, and constantly innovate. You know, how do you constantly keep doing better and better and make this phone so useful for the user? So that's definitely one thing. And then connected experience is another
I think it's almost non-negotiable at this point of time. Everybody has multiple devices. Everybody has devices across various platforms, and they want a connected experience. You know, they want a continuous experience. If my phone is here and I'm wearing a band, and if I have a tablet, everything should be connected. And for that, the most important thing is how much you're leveraging the cloud. How much does every device understand, know who I am, know who my contacts are, and how much of it we're actually putting in the cloud. How much of, we have this big concept of roaming profile. How much of, if I use the diet tracker on the phone, or I'm entering any information, are you storing that somewhere in the cloud? And tomorrow, if my phone gets dropped, or I lost it, or I stole it, just because I have that ID, can everything just start as it is on a new phone? So I think connected experience is an absolutely non-negotiable experience that people totally expect at this point of time.
So you mean to say your band is connected right now?
Yes, absolutely. So this is a Microsoft band. I think it was so cool to see the Google Glass. But I don't know how many of you know that we also launched the Microsoft band a couple of weeks back. So this is one I'm wearing. And it's actually been a great experience. I've worked very closely with this team because it has a lot of health features. But it's just so interesting to see that now there are days when I don't even have to take out my phone from the bag. The phone starts ringing, I look at it and I see, okay, this is one phone I want to avoid. So I don't have to actually worry and take out my phone.
Can I challenge you on that?
You challenge me on what? Sorry?
I'm going to call you.
Okay.
And let's see.
Okay.
Girls? Want to see?
Yes. Okay. So
let
you
me
can
try to actually show her band on the iPad camera while I call her.
You cannot hear me clearly? You cannot see me clearly. Okay. Is this better? Yeah.
So I think they might have,
it could have been pretty much in the purse. So this is actually a very beautiful experience because my wearable, and believe me, when I actually got this wearable, I didn't have to do any setup at all. You know, the companion app, I had to just enter my live ID and that's all. Because now it knows who my, all the folks on my contact list, it knows my Facebook ID, it has my Twitter messages, it has everything. And the whole concept of quantified self, how many of you have heard of quantified self here? Okay, so there's this very interesting concept called quantified self, which is like, how can you measure yourself, you know? And so if all devices and all the things that I use is constantly monitoring me, it sometimes gets scary, but it's interesting that, if my band knows what my heart rate is right now, and my phone and my calendar knows that right now in my calendar, I'm supposed to be speaking here in front of such awesome ladies, then and then you can start putting things together, during which meeting does your heart rate go up? Or when you get a phone call from this person, your heart rate goes up. So there are very, very interesting scenarios when your data, you're getting your steps data, you're getting your calorie data, you're getting your heart rate data, and this is just health. From a productivity point of view, we know where do you go, we know what kind of, how does your calendar look like, what is your travel, because, now Cortana, Siri, all these guys, like Google now, from your email, we know your travel itinerary, we know the weather of the city that you're traveling to. They're just, everything is getting connected. We have so much data about a person that you can actually quantify yourself. And over a period of time, you can start, making these amazing patterns and amazing insights about what am I doing, what's happening with me, what's happening with myself. It's freaky, but it's interesting. And how much of it do you want to actually get into? That's personal choice. A lot of privacy and everything is taken care of, but it's a very interesting concept.
Yeah, so Khushbu talked about devices and connected experience, right? I want to ask Vaishali, in augmented reality, do you face these kind of situations of either a dilemma or something which is unique to a device which you can leverage?
So the thing with, can everybody hear me? Please raise your hand at the back if I'm audible. Yeah, okay, great. So the thing with augmented reality is essentially the technology is overlaying of any digital data on top of the real world. Now, this data could be in the format of rich media like videos, 3D models, animations, simple text. So when we talk about devices, as I mentioned in the beginning of this session, that you really need to have powerful devices to have an actual app which is augmenting any data on anything around you. So as far as devices are concerned, right now it's a possibility only for powerful devices like smartphones and tablets, specifically the iOS and the Android operating systems. But because there are devices coming out, for example, the Google Glass is it takes up on the Android operating system, and there are other wearable computing devices which are built on top of Android or iOS. So those kind of devices are able to handle augmented reality apps. But right now, if you tell me put it on a feature phone, I wouldn't be able to. So the reason why we have it now is because we have the devices to handle it.
So Pragati, can you add on to this in terms of, from the platform side, what are the new things we are seeing coming out in the world?
Okay, before I take that question, I want to tell you that, you know, PayPal app is available on the watch like this, so you can actually go to a coffee shop and you need not take your wallet out of the pocket and pay through the watch. So that's another cool thing that we have. So what was the question again?
It was actually, you answered that partly, about what are the newer capabilities of the platform and the devices that, you know, in general we are seeing, in addition to some that they talked about.
I think what I feel happening in the technology space is convergence, right? Everything is converging together. So the capabilities that I see coming up in devices are that take use of all these features, like, you know, the ability to capture anything and put on the cloud right away, right? The ability to share your likes, your dislikes, your shopping lists, whatever, right? The ability to go global and at the same time go local where you want to find something very close by. So these are the capabilities before, up until now we had to install an app to do it. How can we have them inbuilt within the device? Those are the things that I see are happening.
Okay, that's awesome. I want to take the discussion one step back to simple apps, right? Devices, sensors is a slightly complicated piece, but when we are talking of building a simple app, but for the sake of audience, we want to go from web to phone and so on. Khushbu, is there something that is different for building an app on the phone versus building an app or for the web or the website?
Yeah, so basically, at a high level, your architecture, the first thing is, are you going to choose to build a native app or are you going to choose a web app? That's the first question that everyone has to answer. And there are obviously lots of pros and cons of both. And you have to choose based on your requirements. So for example, if you build a native app for iOS or Android or Windows, then you get a lot of capabilities inbuilt. You can really leverage a lot of stuff that's already done. There's engineering optimization that you can do,
and even the XP.
Hello. Thanks. And even the engineering experience, the user experience can be a little bit more fluid. The advantage with web apps, if you use HTML5 or something, then it's like you build once and then it's available everywhere. But like I've always said, you have to always choose what's best for the customer of your, your app. What's going to make it look best, and from a performance point of view and from a the aesthetic point of view, you choose that. But and the other point to your question is that, are there any different? Yes, at a back-end level, at a middle-tier level and all, you can keep it same. But once you start coming to the client, there are lots of changes, because every phone can be very different. There could be very low-end phones, and you cannot ignore them because they are where you get the huge volume. So those 5,000, 6,000 rupees phones, that's where, you get values. So you cannot ignore them, but then their capabilities might not be as sophisticated and as a very high-end phone, but you still want want to cater to that. So what happens to the performance, you know? So performance optimizations, then the other thing that we at least I didn't quite realize when we started, but then later on I came to know was the we take internet for granted. When you're building web apps or something on the web, right, you know it's going to be on Wi-Fi, you know it's going to be on the LAN, you know, and you know it's going to work. But once it's on phone, it's a huge challenge because then you don't know the user's going, what kind of connections he's getting, flaky connections, connections that will go up and down, 3G, 4G, that's just so much. So add on to that the phone capability, the internet capabilities, everything just, and the computing power of the device. So you have to start making optimizations across the board when you start thinking multiple device, and you cannot just take a lot of stuff that we do take for granted when we just design something for the web. So that's I think the most important.
Yeah. So in the whole gamut of apps, Vaishali, you've built Facebook apps as well. So have you seen difference in either the process or the architecture or just the pace at which an app grows and gathers users? Between building mobile apps versus Facebook apps?
I personally think the biggest concern is the stability of the platform. So for example, if you're developing something for Facebook, now they're very, very infamous for changing the API every 6 months or so. And often the kind of applications that you have to make for Facebook don't get done in that much time. Even when you're kind of going from a beta version to an alpha of a product or any idea, you need at least 6 months to work on it. And if in that time the API changes, as a developer you face a lot of problems. So that's a concern about, you know, Facebook, for example. Again, even with Android, so, you know, there was a huge jump between the build for Android 2 and Android 4. So these kind of things are obviously on developers' wish list, that you know, things remain stable, the platform remains stable. But essentially, I think the whole point of when you create something, whether it's a Facebook application or a web application or a mobile application, and we've done all three, so the only mobile application we've done are all augmented reality-based. So they're very, very different. There are some common practices in terms of the methodologies we use, whether we use a waterfall method of doing things or we use the agile method like I discussed. But essentially everything else is different. The designing, the user approach, how the interaction is happening with the application. So on phones you have, for mobile apps basically it'll be a very, very a touch kind of a thing which has to be very, very simple and quick. For a web application you have to be very, very careful about how much there is on a page and the aesthetics in general. So I think it completely depends on the kind of application you're making.
Yeah, Pragati, you've also been in the mobile space for so long and you've also written a book on Android security. Tell us your findings, you know, either from a security perspective or architecturally or just the whole gamut of platforms you've seen. What are the differences you've seen across and what are the variables that any app maker should be keeping in mind?
Yeah, and I'll give you a security perspective just because of my 10 years with mobile security. Security on the web and security on the mobile devices is very, very different, right? When we were trying to create a PayPal app for mobile, we wanted to share the phone number with the other person. But you know what? In some countries like Germany, the phone number is your personal identifiable information. Now, how would you make a payment system work or anything on mobile work if you do not share the phone number? So these are little things that are nuances, I would say, in mobile devices and web. Again, if you think of a web or a mobile experience, there are huge differences. Usually when you are on a wired desktop, you are working in the comfort of your home or in the office, which has proper firewalls and other security features in place. When you are connected right now on your phone, you are through the Wi-Fi, GHCI, and you have to totally trust the Wi-Fi provider how secure it is, right? Again, I can say that if we by a raise of hands that there would be at least 10 different types of mobile devices, right, by different companies. What they put inside the hardware, we don't know, right? I mean, there could be a little security bug and there was the security bug in Samsung, and it came out, became a really big news, where it was very easy for people to root their Android phones. Now, if that is a bug on your device, it affects everybody who has that particular brand or particular type of hardware. Now, what can you do? You cannot do much about it, right? It's a bug, it's in everything. If you download an app and that has a bug in it, it affects everybody who downloads an app. So these are a lot of, it's the change in dynamics and the change in the way we use mobile and web differently, which is very different.
Yeah. So Vaishali, in the space of augmented reality, and I really want you to tell us the difference between augmented and virtual reality as well. Is there any aspect of personalization, or you know, that thin line of which you can cross or cannot cross in apps that you've come across?
It's actually funny you bring that up, because one of the things that we did as part of a contest, this was a 24-hour hackathon. We developed an augmented reality app for Kama Sutra. It was a competition. And our concept was showing a condom in 3D, kind of sticking out of the phone in your face as an augmentation. So in fact, that was a very, very thin line which we were kind of teetering on. Kama Sutra actually liked it. But they asked us to tone it down a bit, but we did something like that. So as far as crossing the line is concerned, I think that's content dependent, as a point I was trying to make. But in terms of what you can do with the technology, there's no real ethical issue. Now, for example, there's a huge controversy about the Google Glass. People think that their photos can be taken anytime, and their videos can be taken anytime, and they won't get to know. Honestly, that's poppycock, because I can be taking a photo of you on my smartphone. I just have to keep my, you know, on my shutter on silent, and you would never know I'm doing that. I could be taking a video all the time. So just because, in fact, this is transparent, so if I turn it on, you can actually see the screen come on. So you know I'm doing something. And very specifically, I have to give a voice command, or I have to tap it to interact with it. So the whole privacy issue is just, it's kind of, people do it, they create an issue around it. But in terms of the technology itself, so quickly telling you the difference between augmented reality and virtual reality. Augmented reality is when you're augmenting or adding to the world around you. So with digital data, what I'm doing is I'm enhancing the information exchange, which I'm already doing with a certain object or the environment. For example, I am looking at, you know, all of you here right now. Now, suppose I had an application with all of your Facebook profiles loaded into it. So now, as I look at the room, each of you would have a little comic strip pop up on top of your heads declaring your name, maybe a little bit of your bio. Maybe I could see a video if I really wanted about some speech you're giving somewhere or where you work. So that is, that data is enriching the information that I'm already receiving from all of you, right? So that is augmenting. Now, virtual reality is the complete opposite. In virtual reality, what I would do is, you're sitting here, I would give you a pair of glasses to put on. They would not be like this, they would be completely covered. And you would be transported to a different digital world, so to speak, which is so immersive. I mean, the power is mind-blowing. It's so immersive that you literally will not know you're here right now. So I could give you a scenario wherein you're in space, and you will literally feel like you're in a spaceship in space, or that you're on a roller coaster, and you will feel, especially if you have a little bit of, you know, height sickness, you will feel a little ill when you put that on, and you feel like you're in the car. So that complete illusion of reality is virtual reality. So there's a very profound difference between the two technologies. And obviously the applications are often very much hand in hand. For example, something we're doing with the army right now, we're doing virtual simulation for them, in which their soldiers are kind of, they trained in warfare or an actual battlefield or how to drive a tank in a virtual environment. On the other hand, with augmented reality, we're helping them maintain those tanks. So now looking at the tank in front of me, I'm able to understand all the instructions and all the labeling and what part goes where in case I have to operate it with the use of augmented reality. So both the things can actually go hand in hand.
Thanks, Vaishali. But I think one of the points you made was that, you know, this privacy hoo-ha about privacy is a little more blown up than it really is. So, Khushbu, do you share the opinion, or have you seen some, you know, the opposite extreme cases as well? Yeah, health, I mean, is a sensitive
area.
I
have to be very paranoid about privacy because I work in the health segment. So, I mean, for me, if you ask me about my take on privacy, then I always err on the side of being overcautious, and also because, you know, there's one big difference between working for a startup and a big company, because in big company, when you're taking a risk, you're actually taking, you've got Microsoft or Google or Facebook and those names behind you, and you really can't afford to mess up. But yeah, for us, I mean, thankfully we don't have I don't have an example to share with you where it went in the extreme side. I hope I never have an example. But simple things like, you know, I mentioned about all the stuff, the whole quantified stuff. Quantified self stuff. When I'm getting all the medical data about you, and also about your family, simple things which we think will not give us information is actually giving us information. So if you actually went to Bing or Google and you did a search on cancer or on AIDS, you are giving me some information that, you know, there's something about you or your family which is related to that particular disease. So I mean, an example is that, at least for Bing, what we do that while for, you know, simple features like your recent searches, they're very helpful, right? We all like to have these recent searches because very often we go back and click on the same thing. But whenever you make a health query on Bing, we make sure that we don't capture that and we don't ever show that to you, because, and we tell that you know, for those kind of queries we don't. So there are certain things, and I think for certain domains we have to be a little bit more sensitive as compared to certain domain, and obviously I fall in a domain where we obviously like to err on the side. But again, there's a fine balance. For example, for all the medical stuff, if I make the user enter PIN and enter a lot of stuff, that's good. They like it. You know, the more you make them do that, more than a hurdle, they feel good. You know, in all the usability labs. So for example, you'll be, I'll ask a question, spot question. If I ask you, what is a category of apps on iOS and Android on Windows Phone in the health category, which is represented the most in the top 10 apps in the health category? Can anyone take a guess? The kind of apps.
Yeah, the most popular apps in health.
Workouts, okay, that's not the right answer. Sorry?
Weight loss, okay.
Weight loss, close, but not the right answer. Not you, not you. I know you know.
No.
Sorry? Yes, she's right.
Period
it is actually period trackers, you know, the menstruation trackers. That is the number one category represented in health apps. How many of you would know that?
So if you look at the top 10 apps in the health and fitness category, you'll find at least two
bunch
period
of them.
Trackers.
Bunch of them. Okay. And so you can imagine, you know, so like in Windows Phone, we have something like live tiles where we, you know, we show a lot of stuff live on the start screen itself. You really don't have to go inside the app. So we try and do more and more of that because that's like a wow moment. If I track, say, Microsoft stock, I don't have to always keep going inside the finance app. We try and pull the stock out, the stock price, real time, and show it to you on the start tile itself. But imagine if you're using a period tracker, would you ever like a live tile showing you, hello, 2 days left, and then you leave it on your desk, and your colleague walks in and says, really, nice, Prerna, 2 days left. So you wouldn't ever want that, right? So so that's why, even though Lifetile is a very good feature, and even though actually from a usability perspective, user experience perspective, maybe it would be great if on the Lifetile itself I saw that 2 days are left, because then I don't have to, you know, remember. But then there is this whole privacy issue which you have to be very careful about. Similarly, like in Microsoft, we have this big fonts that we use on our phone and our desktop. But when we were making our weight tracker, we ran it through our usability labs. And some of the women, they looked at it and they said, wow, I love your fonts, but no, are you serious? You're going to show my weight in that font size? Imagine if someone is sitting right behind me and sees that I'm like, whatever, 60 kgs or something. No, you have to reduce the size. So these are little things which we don't realize, but it matters to your user. And this all falls under privacy. Privacy is not just this big thing about your bank locker account or something. It's like little information about you, which you have to be careful about.
Yeah, we talked about top 10 apps, right? I want to ask Pragati, how does one get into the top 10? How do platforms rank these, and you know, how can I get into the top 10 if I make an app?
okay, you have to start with a really great quality product, and you have to have that growth, you have to have the awareness about your app. And then finally, you know, all of the app stores have like top 10 lists and these kind of recognitions, or the app of the week that Apple does, things like that. So you have to kind of get in that niche. And one very important way to do it is to keep a track of how many users visited your app, how many people have uninstalled it, how many people installed it. You have to be really, really crisp and clear about that.
Right. So Vaishali, you know, comparing Facebook apps or web apps or mobile apps, how do you measure the app success? You know, she talked about one of it being, you know, how many users are visiting you daily rather than just the number of downloads as a static measure. So in your experience, and you've built apps for so many different clients, what is the measure of success for an app that you should track as an app maker?
So in our case, our clients ask for different types of analytics. So there's some who are interested in, you know, in the viral wave. So they want to see how many people are using their app, more than the quality really. So they just want the numbers. So for them, for a web application, in fact, you know, the Facebook would work in this case in terms of the analytics, because that's what social sharing, that's where really the social sharing happens. Again, on the mobile, same thing. So, you know, the Facebook is very useful there. Some clients want more of a time-based analysis, in the sense that how much time is a user spending on their application or certain sections of the application. So in this, you know, for the web, Google Analytics is something that we use. For mobiles, we use Game Analytics or Flurry, depending on the need. So there are different types of analytics that you can actually expect clients to ask. In our case, you know, it's been clients, but if you're doing your own application, you need to understand what your aim is, who your user is, and what kind of feedback you want from the user. And that's how you kind of figure out, okay, fine, so for this particular feedback that I want, this is the analytics, the tools that I will be using.
Okay, and I want to bring in this dimension of, you know, how do you go global, Khushbu? So I built an app, I launched it in the App Store, and now I see in the App Store that there are so many countries I can make it available in. So what are those nuances of going global?
Actually, many, because, and I have had amazing, interesting stories and experiences around that, because our apps are actually available in more than 150 countries and in so many languages, and because we are a lot of, you know, part of Windows, and Windows, obviously, as you know, is available in so many markets and languages. So there are multiple angles to this, okay? One is just what we call localization. A lot of you are from the product companies would know what localization is. That's simple. Whatever strings that you have in the, you know, on the canvas has to be localized to various languages. It's more of a cost and an operational thing. You know, I mean, if you have a big localization teams in various markets, experts, they translate it. Of course, there are lots of UX considerations to be taken. So for example, you know, all the strings. So now we've become very conscious about, you know, whenever we look at a UX, whenever we look at a page, we think about it. What happens when this gets translated into German? Because that's a very, you know, usually the strings are very long there. Will it get wrapped? Will it get truncated? So those kind of things you have to start building in if you're, you know, that knack of understanding, are we leaving enough space? Are designers actually take care that they give enough padding? You know, these are very small things, but are you giving enough padding when you're putting strings so that when it gets localized, it has enough room to expand? So those are simple things for just simple translation and localization. Then there are there's a second aspect of globalization, where you actually do things like what's the date format in a particular country, what is the currency format in a different what currency they use, etc. So that's the globalization part. And the third part is the content itself, and that is where it gets really challenging if you're building an app which has content. Again, being in the health category, it is, you know, in some countries you cannot talk about certain diseases, certain sexually transmitted diseases. It's a complete no-no. So again, again, this is where even architecturally, it's very smart if you push a lot of things to the cloud. So what we do is we put a lot of capabilities in the cloud to switch on and off markets, and even switch on and on features for a particular market on the fly. So you push everything, but then if you get a complaint from a particular market that, hey, this particular disease or condition cannot be shown, so then we immediately go and, you know, immediately you have to turn around because it's a legal, a geopolitical issue, so you turn it off. And then certain things like, you know, I have an example where all the exercises and workouts that we have in our app, we actually, we created original content. So we partnered with some fitness provider in the US, and they shot 150, you know, more than 1,000 actually workouts and exercises for us. And a program manager from my team was there shooting on the location, and he would go nuts because he would get a call from some market, the market PM from there, and he would say, you know what, the model cannot wear anything above the knee. It has to be, you know, she has to wear slacks and her shoulder has to be covered. And then someone from US would call and say, hey, if you actually have a model with like shoulders covered and, you know, like wearing slacks below knees, are you kidding me? I mean, are you serious? She's going to do workouts and you think people are going to follow? It's not going to happen. And this guy was going nuts. What do I actually make the models wear? So at the end of it, we had to do a compromise, and we built, we had like different kinds of attires and workout clothes, and we made some models wear some kind of clothes, and then we turned off some exercises and workouts. So, I mean, you would never imagine such, you know, things like that come up, but they do, and you have to be prepared. So content actually throws in a much bigger challenge than localization and globalization, because that's something that we have been doing for a long time, and we've kind of, we know, you know, the ropes of how to do that. But content was a huge thing for me, especially in the business that I am.
Yeah, so now that you bring in the content angle, right, Pragati, do you want to talk a little bit more about, you initially briefly mentioned about subscription model, which is about, you know, which suits content and media kind of apps. So can you tell us a little bit more about this type of apps, which are very content driven, and overall about, you know, how do we succeed? How do we deal with content, content security, content monetization?
Yeah, lots of things, right?
Yeah.
So before I jump onto that, let me add a little bit on what Khushbu said. You know, when you go global, let me add the payment flavor to it as well. Because when you step into the payments world, each country, and you're trying to go global, and we are in 202 countries, so each country has its own rules, its own regulations, its own tax percentage, its own way of dealing with banks, so its own currency, you know, do's and don't do's. So that's another aspect of globalization that comes into the picture, which is very use case specific. On the content side, you know, these days we have different kinds of contents, right? Not just media in the sense of reading a magazine. There is live streaming, there's Netflix, there is, what was that, TiVo, that was actually doing some, and is currently doing, they're building all these media platforms, right? Security definitely is a big issue out there, because like we recently had this issue where a lot of where the cloud accounts of a few movie stars got leaked and the pictures came in the on the web. So those kind of things are there, can happen all the time. And also what you are recording and what you are putting on the web for everybody else to access, it's important to be very careful about that.
Okay, so I think we've got this many different dimensions of app making. We started with designing and then architecture and Facebook versus native mobile apps. We talked about the architectural differences, device capabilities, sensors, going global, making money. I think it's fun time now. Should we embark the rapid fire round?
But I have a question. Where's the hamper? Hamper, like the coffee with Karan has a hamper, right?
So
I mean, you torture us so much, so
I'll do is I'll give you mugs. I'm gonna ask for your autographs on the mugs, and while I get the autographs, I want you guys to think of some really wacky questions, because the best questions, if you target your question to a specific speaker, right? And if she likes your question, she gives you her autographed mug. All right? And the question has to be really rapid fire. So it has to be really crisp, one word, two words, just shoot. Okay, I'll start off so that you get a couple of more minutes to think over your questions. I'll start off with a few easy ones and you can bring in the more difficult ones. But before that, let me ask you for your autographs. So this is your mug. This is yours. This is yours. Please give me an autograph on the mug.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah. So let me start with a very easy question. The best app you've seen? Best app?
Can I include my app? And
can she include her app?
No.
Okay, if I can't include my app, then...
the other one.
I'll take the app. I'll be spoiled for choices, quite a few. It's a tough question. But I would say the app that I use most, other than obviously Facebook, Twitter, and WhatsApp, is Amazon app. And I think it's pretty good. It's very clean. It remembers me. That's what I like. I am assuming it's the Amazon team. But yeah, it is the Amazon team, I recognize. So I think it's very clean. One thing was a complete wow moment for me is but I had an account in the US Amazon. And then when I actually downloaded it on Windows Phone, I have it on Android, it always remembered me, all my accounts, all the orders. And it's very clean, you know, the UX. I'm a very minimalistic person as far as UX is concerned. It's very minimalistic. So I really like it. So
yeah, I'll second that. Actually, Amazon team. So I can quote here that Amazon has remembered me for like something like 2 years. Even before Amazon.in came in, I used to visit Amazon.com only when I'm flying or when somebody's coming from there. And I remember that 2 years later, it still had what I had visited and what was in my cart lying around. So it really made me feel like, oh, you really know me. You know what I like to buy. So that's awesome. What about Pragati, your favorite app? Not the PayPal app.
Okay. My favorite app is Pinterest.
Okay. And yours?
WhatsApp. It helps me stay connected, so I love WhatsApp.
So anyone from the audience want to call up from some of the wacky apps they've seen that you've really loved?
Instagram.
Okay. Yeah. So now coming to slightly more. Yeah.
Snapchat.
Yeah. So now coming to slightly more tricky questions. Vaishali, tell us about the craziest thing you've had to do in an app, just to get things done.
So actually, this is something my partner tricked me into doing. So one of our clients wanted an application which would face track. So women would kind of come, take a selfie, and they'd have different hairstyles on their heads, right? So we were just experimenting for it. So he says, you know, why don't you come and sit and make funny faces? I'm just testing the application. And I do that, and the next thing I know, the video's up on YouTube. It's been sent to the client. It's public, and my face is there with a skeleton on top of it, which is making weird faces and and funny expressions. And then after that, I mean, that's not the end. Then he puts Batman on top of my face. So I'm just like, thank you for sharing that, but okay.
Okay, Pragati, some crazy ways of making money. I'm not saying dishonest, you can, but some crazy ways of making money.
So actually, what has been on the top of my list was what I heard from Jane today. To spread the word around Unilever, they actually created an app that plays nonstop music and throws in ads of their products in the middle. And so people don't have to pay for the music and they get advertisement for their Unilever products in Bihar and Jharkhand. And they got like 80 million. Don't quote me on that, but that many users, they acquired so many users in a few months. So that has risen to the top of my chart now.
Yeah, so that was about wacky ways or dishonest ways, if you want to add something.
It's an honest way.
Yeah, but have you seen dishonest ways of making money in apps?
Yeah, you hack into the app and you get all the money. The person is doing a transaction. We see that all the time in PayPal. People make money in dishonest ways by doing a lot of wacky stuff.
So, Khushbu, one non-Microsoft app which you would have liked to build and you feel you would have done better than what it is?
By non-Microsoft,
my mic keeps going. I think email on iOS and Android. I think I would have done a better job because I don't know how many of you are Windows Phone users here, but Windows Phone, I think email is very good. And I mean, we all live on email all the time. And whenever I've tried to use iOS and Android, I love a lot of things about them. So, but then I think still the fluidness and the just natural things of Outlook especially, I mean, I think that. And the other thing is, it's not an app, but I wish that iOS and Android, the page, the start screen was a little more live and more engaging as it is in Windows. So I would have made that the tiles a little more live and engaging. So these are two things.
Okay. Vaishali, virtual reality or virtual functions? What's more
virtual
interesting?
Virtual reality.
Way more interesting,
hands down.
Okay. Pragati, the best mobile payment method?
When you don't have to take your wallet out of the of your pocket and you buy something and just walk out of the store.
Okay. Khushbu, what comes to your mind when I say Android and iOS?
Android, huge volume. iOS, very fluid, beautiful UI, responsive.
And your app is on Windows, so you don't...
But it's coming soon on Android and iOS.
Oh, okay. So I actually expected her to talk more about Windows than Android, iOS.
No. I think all these platforms have, I mean, if I had to pick one from each of them and made this dream platform, I would have definitely picked the volume that Android enjoys. I mean, you cannot beat that and you have to give it to them. iOS, I just love the fluidity, you know, it's just so beautiful, the responsiveness, etc. And like always, I've already mentioned the Windows Phone one, it's my platform, so I love it. And the other thing is, I think the start screen. I just love the start screen, the fact that I just see the Microsoft stock price on my start screen. I don't have to go inside the news, my Facebook comments, etc. I think it's just if you, and that's why I, as a company, I mean, you must have heard, we Office is now available on iOS and we're working on Android, etc. So I think it's we're not living in an age where we can say we're going to build this only for one platform. All the platforms have their own strength, and it is definitely an age where users use multiple devices, so we have to go cross-platform in the true sense of the word.
True. So all of you ready with your questions? I'm just going to grab a mic and walk across. Ready? And so if you like a question, you can give away your mug. And we'll go on till the mugs are given. Yeah? So can I take a mic? Sorry. Who wants to go first?
So many. Technology.
Who are you asking it to?
All three of you. No, I mean, we all know. Vaishali. if you go into real virtual world and you talk about smart homes and technology being used to revive the life beyond, I mean, not currently. So do you think it will take over humanity? And some of the things which human feel...
Rapid fire.
Yeah. So humanity or technology? I mean, your chance. When will you stop technology and say humanity?
Am I allowed to be diplomatic?
No, this is rapid fire.
So I think I would choose humanity because honestly, without us, there would be no technology. So humanity is what keeps everything else alive. So absolutely humanity.
There should be a line drawn.
Yes.
Next.
Hi, I'm Amrita. Pragati, I have a question for you. Which is the most hyped about app that you've seen? Lot of hype, but you felt it was like...
Okay, this is a tricky one.
So if you like it, you can give away your mug.
Yeah, you actually made me think so hard. Let's see. Most hyped app. I don't find a use for Instagram really in my life. So that's what I believe in. I know it's controversial, but I don't have it on my phone.
Okay, you like the question enough to give you a mug, or you want to wait for a more interesting question?
Okay, I'll wait.
Okay, great. Next question.
What if there was no Android or, iOS? This question is for you, Kushbu. You know, I just wake up one day and then you know that there's no Android or iOS and all you have is just Windows.
Sorry, I couldn't hear your question. I can repeat that.
Can you repeat?
The question is, one day you wake up and you find there is no Android, no iOS. What's going to happen?
Oh, I'll be very happy. There's only Windows and we're... the stock price goes up. No. That was my instant reaction that I'll be happy. The diplomatic answer is no. I think the world will not be a good place because, there are great platforms and they should be around. And so,
competition makes us be better.
Sorry?
There's no other platform, obviously, to get everyone onto your platform.
Yes. So, yeah, that'll be good. But I think this is not a diplomatic answer, but the reality, slowly most of the applications that we are building is going cross-platform. So, if a user is using Office on Android, I think as a company we're equally happy because he is going to be an Office 365 customer and he is going to be using our PowerPoint and our Word doc. And if he's on iOS, so be it. For us it's user. Wherever the user is and if he's using our product, that's fine. So I think that's where we are.
Yeah, next question.
So now WhatsApp is already established and a very well-known application, right? So what if you are planning to develop similar applications, what all challenges you are thinking you will have to have?
Yeah,
and what all the thought process?
Who are you asking the question?
Vaishali.
Vaishali.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear that.
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, when you have one established application, you know it is already user-friendly and lots of users are using it.
Right.
And you are planning to again, develop one more application, similar application on that. So what are the challenges and exactly what is the thought process will go behind to build one?
So are you saying for another client, like a B2B application or a B2C application?
Either way, so basically the thing is you have to build a concept that already exists. So
how would I deal with that? Honestly, if the concept already exists and somebody has done it, then I don't see why you either can do or cannot do it, depending on how that concept has worked. So the thing with ideas is, I believe that the idea is everywhere, just floating around in the universe. If I think of something today, probably 10 other people have already thought of it or will think of it today or tomorrow. And the difference between all of us will be the person who's implemented it. So, like you said, if an idea has already been implemented, then I would probably go to it, look at it, see its drawbacks or see how it's worked, and then if I think that my version of it has something more to offer the world, I would absolutely go ahead with it.
Next.
Hi, I actually like that question, so I think I'm going to give my mug to her. But that doesn't mean I don't get other questions, you can still ask.
Vaishali, there's another question for you. This is Pratibha. I just want, like everyone have heard about Disney World, so they show that transformation of the wallpapers, they design a new room and when you walk in you can change your colors and you can just shoot all the entire your memories on the wall. So do you have any idea for the virtual reality to use it in real life? Like in real, when you walk in you can actually see the virtual reality around you. And so, between you.
So are you asking if that's possible?
No, and I'm for thinking everyday if you're given a chance, what will be your take on this?
So, in fact, one of the things we are doing right now, as I said, for the army is creating an entire virtual battlefield for them, wherein they not only understand battle tactics and strategy, basic tactics, in a completely controlled environment, which is virtual, so they're not actually being gunned down or shot by real bullets. So, so that is, in fact, probably giving them life skills. something that tomorrow in actual war situation would really help them. If you take the same concept to a more consumer oriented level, this is something that we're pitching in fact to a lot of people who are in real estate. Imagine if you're trying to sell a luxury condo to somebody or a building, and you know that person does not have the time to come all the way in the outskirts and see it. What you can do is you can just take it to them. So you need to go with just this device and
another color, or today I want my wallpaper to be painted in a different view, and tomorrow I just want to change it completely.
Right.
So that is what virtual reality I'm talking about in a real life.
So are you asking if that is possible? If I can do it, so that means I would be living in a virtual room at all times. Absolutely. So I mean, if I could do that, I'd absolutely do it for myself. So every day, you know, one day I'd see Steve Jobs complimenting me. One day I'd see I'd see Tom Cruise like proposing, serenading outside the balcony. One day I'd see like a fancy valley somewhere, because I just want to get away from urban life and I want some greenery around me. Absolutely. If we could develop something like that, we absolutely will.
Yeah. So before we move to the
there's also a possibility to build an app like that via platforms like Kinect. So you connect a Kinect to a projector and you write an app. You give your room, it's possible by the way, you can you give your room layouts and everything, and then you can choose what you want to see on the room on the wall and all. So it's possible. But I don't know if there's an app like that or not.
So I think
that
the conclusion was yes, it's possible, and two, if all three seem to say that if they...
I do not know if there's an app like that or not, but as an engineer, I know it is possible to build it.
It's absolutely possible, yes. She's right. You can use Kinect. Yeah.
Ripple is there.
Yeah. We have an inbuilt app in the company
Yeah, I think before we go to the next question, I want the cup giving ceremony to happen with the first mark, please. So more questions. I think I want to go to the back tables first. I'll come back in the front.
So I don't know if my question is relevant, but I want to know if...
Who are you asking?
To Pragati. So I want to know if you think there's a buzz area in terms of app development that you see. Like, I feel social networking and games is already kind of saturated. So what do you think would be the next buzz in terms of app domains?
It's going to be convergence. It's going to be creating apps that bring these technology trends together. Social, global, local, and going digital. That's what I believe.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, next question.
Okay, I have two questions. One wacky one, which I'll compete for the mug, and another normal question. So I'll go with the boring question first. We spoke a lot about app monetization and app discoverability, right? And what developers can do. And I'm going to flip that problem around and ask what platforms like iOS and Android and Windows should be doing to make lives easier for developers to help them monetize better and make their apps more discoverable. So that's my first question.
That's for me, right?
Yeah.
Okay. To make monetization easier, what Android and iOS have to do is to provide the capability of a secure element or somewhere where people can store their credentials safely, like bank account details and other payment related information.
Okay. I'll go to the wacky question.
Just to add on to that, I think we're seeing a lot of changes happening in the payment methods more recently, right? I mean, this kind of payment. She also talked about a few of them. And so devices making payments is coming in, and that is something which will take care of multiple aspects. And it opens up a whole lot more opportunities for app developers to start monetizing.
Thanks. Right?
So the wacky question.
Yes. My question is for Khushbu. If you woke up one morning and realized you had become an app on your phone, which app would that be? And you can't say Bing Health and Fitness.
Sorry?
If you woke up one morning and realized you had become an app on your phone, which one would that be? And you can't say the health and fitness.
WhatsApp, because I'll be hugely popular.
A good one.
Hi, my question is to Khushbu. I really like that watch, first thing. So I'm going to be, you know, looking at the price of that once I go back.
It's cheaper than the Apple Watch.
Okay.
Just in case you didn't notice.
No, it had a lot of, you know, interest when it came to me. But then my question to you is, we are right now talking about a lot about, you know, women's safety, children's safety.
Mm-hmm.
And when it comes to children's safety, I think you're looking for something which, knowing children, you know, they just tend to break things very fast and stuff like that. But we are, you know, interested in their safety. So have you thought about something, you know, which can be done with the same watch that you have on your hand, which is going to help in this concern?
Yes. You know, in fact, that's my favorite interview question, just in case anyone is. So a lot of times, you know, we think about, can we use certain these bands? It's you know, it can actually not just be used for children's safety. It can also be used a lot for people who are, you know, have Alzheimer's or have those kind of, you know, old age people. So we've actually brainstormed a lot on it. And we might, and actually, in fact, in the market today, there are a few bands that have been introduced, which are actually specific to kids. You can go and research a little bit about it. But then, the big question here is that, what age group are you targeting? Because if you're really targeting young kids, like young as in, you know, 3 to 5 years, then it's fine. But the moment they're 8 years, 10 years, they don't want to be tracked. You know, that's another thing. You do not want to be uncool to these teenagers. The moment they say, oh my God, my so see what's happening with WhatsApp and, you know, the new messenger that came up, Hike. You see their ads, you know. Their ads actually say that you can turn off that ability to say last online at what time, you know, which WhatsApp has. Because, and the whole ad is targeted towards the fact that, hey, your mom and your dad and your friends can't track you. So that's a very important aspect for children. When we think about children beyond 10, you have to start thinking about their mentality. So as a parent, you really worry, but then will they like it? So that's one first question, and you don't want to lose them. You don't want to become uncool to them. You know, don't want to become that big daddy on in front of them. That's one thing. But I definitely think there's a lot of potential. And safety is one aspect, but even from a health perspective, you know, a lot of times, you know, we have these childhood obesity problem. So how can you make pedometers more, you know, exciting for them? And I think the potential is there for old age people. You know, I'm, you know, people with Alzheimer's and stuff, and that's another potential. Yes, so we've debated about it, but there's a little bit of, you know, audience profiling and thinking about what the user will like and not like.
Yeah, so next we have...
Okay, I'm sorry, I don't remember the names. The one sitting in the center.
Pragati.
And there are these malicious apps like Telegram. Now, how do we safeguard people against that? Is there something where it can be authenticated, like a, you know, VeriSign check that we have for online payment? So similarly, is there anything for apps where, you know, they can get that authenticated check to make sure that, you know, people are not getting fooled? Plan to, you know, get there.
Say that?
How do we plan to get there? Because, you know, if I'm going and, you know, taking or, you know, downloading some app, mm-hmm. I want to make sure that, you know, I'm not kind of promoting
right.
people who are, you know, using it in a malicious way.
Right. So, as I said, currently there's no way. On Android, the way you can do it is looking at the permissions. Whenever my son gets my phone, he downloads like 10 or 20 games on my on my phone, and they all of them make my phone so slow. So I wish there was. I guess the only way right now is to look at the permissions and do it. Apple does a better job because they only allow apps that have gone through a rigorous compliance process to be uploaded on the App Store. But really though. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And there are also cases where, you know, 14-year-old kids could actually bypass the rules of Apple and get their app on their App Store. So yeah, those are all possible.
Yeah, we have one question from here.
So my question is for Khushbu. So what is that one situation where you have felt, oh my God, why isn't there an app for this?
Like, sorry?
What is that one situation where you have felt, why isn't there an app for this, you know, this use case? I mean, why has no one built an app here?
kids' homework. Yeah, that's I say that every day. You come back home, and especially, there are so many instances related to kids' homework where I was like, oh my God, I wish there was just one app we could, you know, it would every day come, detect what, you know, read their diaries, scan it, figure out what the homework is, get them disciplined, make them sit and do the homework. So, yeah, that is.
Yeah. I wish there was a maid tracker as well.
Yes, maid tracker.
So I know beforehand if my maid is coming today or not.
Yeah, we have one question.
Okay, so my question is for Vaishali. With apps, you know, the whole concept was really on focusing on one or two things and specializing in it and doing it really well. And now we have a huge proliferation of apps, depending on the platform you look at. So I want to know your thoughts on discoverability, how people can come to know the coolest apps that are happening, so many, how do you choose something that's right? And then the second question is, there are so many ecosystems, like for example, search engines, where people want to give you answers right there in place, and they don't want people to leave and go into some app or some cool things and lose the eyeballs. So how do you see these two things balancing out in the future? I want to hear some thoughts on that.
Can you repeat the second part, the second thing?
So the second part is, recently there's been a lot of news about search engines and answers that they give. So if you're asking for, let's say, a stock price or something on a search engine, and you get it right in there. And basically, there's a race for many web properties. They don't want the clicks to go away, to go out of their surface area into some app or some other thing, because the user might not return. So, you know, how do you balance out between this one solution for everything kind of thing that search engines many times aspire to be, and these apps which specialize in one activity, one single activity, which leads to like a host of apps and managing issues?
So actually, this is a really, really long answer, so we'll probably have to take it offline. But to tell you quickly from, say, the augmented reality point of view, just limiting myself to that sector, it's essentially the technology. So the app that you're making, and based on the sector that you're aiming it for and the kind of users it's for, it changes everything. So today there might be 20 companies in India working on the same technology. But when people ask us, so how are you different? It's because our sector is different, the way we use the technology is different, our expertise level is different, and our target audience is completely different. So even though all of us may be working with augmented reality as a branch, I cannot call any of them my competitors. So we are all able to exist in the same ecosystem. All of us can create applications for clients, for the B2C level, for consumers, but it would not be competitive because we're just using the base technology, which is similar. And in a wider context, I think we'll take it offline because that's a very long answer for you.
Because I work on the search engine, I work in the Bing team, as well as I work with a lot of partners who might have concerns like this. So whether Google and Bing and these search engines have these instant answers, so you're right. In a way, we are cannibalizing them, right? So if there is a particular app which has stock prices, and if on google.com or bing.com you go and you say MSFT or Google and you get the answer, the user might not ever go to that app. I think that was your question, right? But the one interesting aspect in this is a lot of these providers might not be as big, right? They might not have the volume that Google or Bing might have. Imagine, you know, those are search engines. People come there for a variety of reasons. So even if we are cannibalizing them for a little fraction, the return that they get is much more. They would rather surface as a content provider on Google and Bing than not be there at all, because the user will either ways go to the search engine, right? So you'd rather partner with them and show your answer, because, you know, I mean, chances are two times you're going to see the stock price, but the third time you might want to go and dig deeper as to why. You know, you might want to play with the charts, you might want to read the news, you might want to read the statistics of the company and understand why the stock price is there. At that time you will go and dig into that link which comes with the instant answer, and you would go to the provider. And that third time, then every third person from a search engine who's going to that app is a user acquisition for that app, you know. And that kind of a third person on Google is still much bigger than their entire volume in the entirety, you know. So that way, so that's why, you know, even though it looks as a cannibalization, it actually isn't, and content providers are very, very happy to work with search engines and get them surfaced at the top. So
So I think we are almost done on time. So I'm just going to go with two more who had raised their hands earlier. One is here and one is last one to you. Okay.
Hi, I'm Neha. I'm come from Time Inc. And my question is for Vishali. Vishali, as a startup, how important do you think is patenting of ideas that contributes towards the success of any app? As in, I want to build a new app which should be unique. And I want it to be a great success, but do you think patenting would contribute towards the success of that app?
Personally, the whole concept of startup and patent is actually sort of like a contradiction, because you're so small, however much you try to patent what you have, there are always loopholes, right? So somebody else can build on top of what you're doing or change a little bit, and then you see that your idea is gone. So if you're actually so concerned about your idea and you think that somebody's going to steal it, then you probably need to relook at your competition and how you're going to kill it, because the biggest thing about an idea and the contributor to its success is how easy is it for other people to implement the same thing, right? Now today when Apple came out with the iPhone, how long did it take Samsung to create a phone which was similar in features or in the device, right? So if it was something that was very easy to be done, then you probably have to relook at the entire ideation, where you're going wrong. If it's something so easy to replicate, it's very, very likely that you will be killed with competition, especially if you're a small startup right in the beginning, right? And this, in fact, you see a lot in the pharma sector. In fact, over there, in spite of patenting and whatever they do, pharma startups, they're either like threatened and completely like they're bought or they're killed. Right, so it's because they are startups, it's because they are small. So patenting, I don't really think helps. But obviously, if you're going in for investments, etc., it's always good to have it in your portfolio. That, you know, if you have developed something unique, then patenting is great. You know, the IP is important in that way. Yeah.
Okay. So the last question now. I had seen her raise her hand when I asked for wacky questions. So, and she's been giggling. So.
No, this one's from Pragati, and just on a lighter note,
okay.
You work with a money-related app.
Yeah.
Have you ever lied to make money? it could be personally, professionally,
you take
anything.
You take me back to my my younger days when I used to lie to get pocket money and buy books, and I read lots of books and go movies, so yeah.
So do you like the question enough to give her the mug?
Yes.
You should give her the mug.
Please.
Yes. Yeah, iOS and Android disappears one day.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, and we have... So thank you. Thank you for the wonderful discussion. I hope all of you enjoyed it and are a little more enlightened about the whole journey of app making. And we'll close it bang on time. Thank you. Have they responded?
Yeah. Let's give it up to them for one more time. Please collect mementos from ABI as a token of appreciation.
So I think one of the things we wanted to do here, apart from this session, was in the Microsoft booth, there was a quiz. And some of you have participated in that. And
one of the winners from the quiz, and one we had is the lucky draw. So first we'll be announcing the quiz winner.
So I think there was a contest at the Microsoft booth.
And two winners have been selected to get a brand new Microsoft Lumia 730 phone. And I think a bunch of you took selfies. So this is the phone that you were taking selfies with, not the same phone. Of course, we are giving you a new phone. But this is the model that you were using. So it's a fabulous phone. The first winner is Madhuri N. Oh, wow. I'm sorry. I'm just as excited as you are, as you can see. Thank you so much for coming to the Microsoft booth. Congratulations. Okay, and then the second one is going to be through a lucky draw. And
I want to pick.
Prerna is going to pick up the phone.
No,
and this is also a Microsoft Lumia 730. And by the way, this also has the pedometer that I was talking about, so you can track your steps using this.
And the winner is?
Anuja, anujavarma91@gmail.com.
Amazon.
Amazon.
No?
Is anyone from Amazon here?
No, we should.
Okay, we'll pick someone else. Diniti, are you here?
Okay, one more.
If we don't get one more, then we'll have to we'll just figure out where Anuja is, and she's got her email, so we'll give it to her. How many of you actually went to the mic? How many of you think your names are here? Okay, so there are just a few. So the Prithvi, Pritam Rock1@gmail.com. Are you here?
Okay, so Anuja gets
okay, so let's give it to Anuja from Amazon. We'll only give it if she was here at least for some time. Just kidding, we'll figure out and we'll give it to her. So this is Nokia Lumia 730. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
I think I'd quickly like to thank all of you all. I think you should all clap for yourselves for being such a wonderful audience with your brilliant questions. Yes. All of us, you know, we feel like...
My pleasure. She wants a picture. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.